Mona, on this story on Al Jazeera and specifically focusing on the U.S. response to the Israel-Palestine conflicts, joining me now is Phyllis Bennis. She's a fellow at the Institute for Policy Studies and author of the recent book, Understanding the Palestinian-Israeli Conflict. Phyllis is joining us via Skype from Washington. Very good to have you with us on Al Jazeera. I want to talk to you about the U.S. response to the conflict. As we heard from our correspondent in Washington earlier, President Biden's message is what we've heard from American presidents of both parties, whether Republican or Democrats, for decades. But this conflict, it seems, is being viewed differently in the U.S. this time around. What do you think has changed?
I think what has not changed, as you say, is the position so far of the Biden administration. What we know about the conversation between President Biden and the Israeli Prime Minister and Mahmoud Abbas is that he has not called for a ceasefire. He has not put any pressure on Israel to stop the slaughter that's underway in Gaza. And that this is a very familiar situation in which it appears that the U.S. is taking the lead from Israel on when they are ready for a ceasefire. And Netanyahu has made clear he is not ready for a ceasefire. He said that our aim is to send Hamas a message, right, that it's not worth sending these rockets. He is still sending that message. And this is very reminiscent of earlier situations in 2006 with the Israeli war on Lebanon. Condoleezza Rice, then the Secretary of State to George Bush, said, we don't want a ceasefire yet,
right,
implying presumably there were not enough dead people yet. And
right,
we see something similar here. It's quite dangerous.
Well, what would constitute a red line, do you think, for the Biden administration? As you said, he's largely stuck to the old regional script. Everyone thought that he would do better than Trump on this thorny issue with the years of experience he's had. Why this low-key approach? Why is the U.S. so unwilling to apply the same standards of justice to Israel as it's applied everywhere else in the world?
There's a long answer and a short answer. The long answer has to do with the so-called special relationship that is both a political and a strategic relationship with Israel that has led to a situation where it has long been assumed to be political suicide for any politician, including a president, to seriously challenge Israeli aggression. It is not political suicide, but unfortunately, too many people in Washington have not recognized that shift in reality. On the immediate level, President Biden came in saying very clearly, foreign policy is not my priority. My priority is the pandemic and the economy.
Right.
And to the degree that I'm going to deal with foreign policy at all, it's China and Iran and not Israel-Palestine. Mm. Now he has a Israel-Palestine policy, which is exactly what President Trump left him, meaning these extremist positions, moving the embassy to Jerusalem, mm-hmm, recognizing settlements as somehow legal, calling for annexation of territory. These are not Biden's own positions.
Right.
But until he changes it, he is stuck with those as his policy.
Right.
So right now, the question is his envoy in the region, Hadi Amer, is he prepared to actually tell the Israelis that there will be serious consequences, not just stern words, not just words of concern, but real consequences in terms of no longer supporting Israeli violations by providing funding, no longer protecting Israel from being held accountable in the International Criminal Court, et cetera.
Right.
Until that happens, there's no reason to think the Israelis are going to pay attention.
You talked about Biden focusing more on domestic policy rather than foreign policy, but there are those who would say that the issue of Israel is almost a domestic policy in the United States. Right now, we're hearing more and more voices within the Democratic Party, progressive Democrats, especially challenging the party establishment. Could these voices within the Democratic Party get even more louder and be more transformative to the point that we could see a shift, perhaps?
I think that we will see it. I hope that it happens sooner rather than later. The shift is on two levels. We're seeing now for the first time in Congress, members of Congress who are prepared to stand up and defend Palestinian rights, Palestinian children. On Thursday night, there was an hour-long session, special session of Congress, where 20 members of Congress got up to make direct speeches in support of holding Israel accountable and Palestinian rights in various forms. That had never happened before. We also are seeing a massive shift among Democratic Party voters, where support for Israel is now a partisan issue in a way that it never was before. The support for Israel is overwhelmingly a Republican position among voters. You don't see this distinction among members of Congress, but you do see it among the voters. And when members of Congress start to realize this, that support for, in the last poll just a few months ago, support for the Israeli government, favorable views towards the Israeli government, were in the mid to high 60s for Republicans, but in the mid 20s for Democratic voters. That's a huge shift. It's a huge divide, a partisan divide. And that means there is room for the incredible movement for Palestinian rights that has been working for 20 years plus in this country and has had real success at changing the political discourse, the public discourse, the shift among African Americans, shifting towards support for Palestinian rights. The shift within the Jewish community has been extraordinary in recent years. And all of that is absolutely going to have a significant shift. It's going to lead to a significant shift in voting patterns in Congress. The question is, how long will it take to get to that point where it's not just the public discourse, it's not just the media discourse that's also changing, but it's also a policy discourse that changes? That's the next step, and that's what we have to move towards.
Thank you very much for talking to us about this. Phyllis Bennis joining us there from Washington. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.